Welcome, everyone. Thank you for joining the 2018 Globe Ethics webcast series today. My name is Stephen Duvall. I'm the executive producer of CITVN and function as the Globe Ethics United States Regional Representative. I apologize for the delay that this morning. To those of you who have stayed with us, thank you, and we apologize for any inconvenience. Let me start by saying that Globe Ethics is a global network of 195,000 persons and institutions interested in various fields of applied ethics. It offers access to a large number of resources on ethics, especially through its leading global digital ethics library, and facilitates collaborative web-based research, conferences, online publishing, and information sharing. CITVN is a documentary and webcast production cooperative business owned and operated by a Catholic worker movement community of homeless people. We copyright and distribute these lectures for free to 46,000 subscribers under a Creative Commons license to include over 20,000 professors in 216 Catholic universities and the directors of religious education and pastors in 16,000 parishes. Our presentations make use of educational fair use content. Our music selections are acquired in the Internet Archives under a Creative Commons license. This is a Zoom webinar. Following each presentation, we will invite you to ask questions in chat. If you're attending the web conference in Facebook or YouTube Live, please feel free to use the chat, and I will be pleased to moderate your questions for you. Feel free to talk with one another in chat during the conference. We want you to make new friends. So far, we have over 274 registrants from 76 countries. Today's keynote presentation by Professor John Onyango will be followed by some announcements. Before we get started, I want to mention that the United Nations Scientific Panel on Climate Change released a new report last month that paints a far more dire picture of the immediate consequences of climate change than previously thought, and says that avoiding the damage requires transforming the world economy at a speed and scale that has, and I quote, no documented historic precedent. I'll put a link for the IPCC report and the most recent U.S. climate assessment reports in chat in just a minute. Before I introduce today's speaker, I want to remind you that we're streaming live on our Globe Ethics Live website and on the Globe Ethics Facebook page, where you can view the recorded lectures. If you have at least 5,000 Facebook friends, we offer to stream for free the Globe Ethics webcast to your page to help you grow your environmental social network. I'll also post those links for you in chat in just a minute. Our keynote speaker today is Professor John Onyango. John is an associate professor of architecture at the School of Architecture, University of Notre Dame. He has a Doctor of Philosophy degree in architecture from the University of Glasgow, a Master of Architecture degree from the University of Notre Dame, a Certificate in Professional Practice and Management in Architecture from the Bartlett School of Architecture, University College London, and a Bachelor of Architecture Honors degree from the University of Nairobi, Kenya. John's research primarily focuses on sustainability in the broad sense that takes holistic approaches to the creative practice at the building and urban design levels that is both interdisciplinary as well as multidisciplinary in collaboration with other colleagues in the allied fields such as engineering, sociology, healthcare, and IT communications. John suggests future research should focus on two main hazards, floods and heat waves. These two areas continue to be active research areas for John. His lecture today is titled Climate Change and the Built Environment. Ladies and gentlemen, Globe Ethics is proud to present Professor John Onyango.
Ladies and gentlemen, My name is John Onyango. As you've heard, I'm an associate professor of architecture at the University of Notre Dame. And I'm going to talk to you today about climate change and the built environment. Global temperature and sea level rise is projected to actually increase. If you look at temperature rises, we're looking at anything between 1.8 degrees centigrade to a worst scenario of about 4 degrees centigrade between 1990 and 2100. So as he pointed out, the current report shows 1.5 degrees, which is quite dire as it is. Mainly, the general introduction is that you will have a lot of rain increasing or snow increasing, variability is going to occur. And we're going to have a lot of extreme events increasing. In some cases, they're going to be dire to see hurricanes occurring the last couple of years, getting severe, or cyclones getting severe. In terms of sea level rise, we're looking at anything between 9 to 88 centimeters, which is 3.5 to 34 inches through thermal expansion mania. And a lot of this is actually caused by what we call anthropogenic climate change, which is caused by human beings. Best estimate for low level, again, is 1.8, likely 1.1 to 2.9. So this is all very consistent. If you look at the graph that we have over here, we can see that even the best case scenario, we're going to have an increase in temperature change. Worst case scenario is quite dire, about 3 to 4 degrees almost, which is quite terrible. Even the best case scenario, we're going to have an increase in temperature. Now, as we start this, I'd like to take you to this statement of a young child. It's a cartoon where a young child is asking the dad, "Dad, how comes they tell us about weather in, so say, 50 years from now, but they can't really focus tomorrow?" Well, the reality is that predicting weather is very, very difficult. It's very, very challenging in real life. So if you look at, say, 15-year period, we can actually predict very quickly. However, looking back the last 100 years of records, we can see the trend is actually increasing. And that's the key thing, that we're dealing with these trends. Global trends are actually about increase in temperature and increase in sea level rise. Now, what are the effects of this? Now, climate change is expected to have a major influence in certain types of diseases. One, both temperature and humidity are likely to play a role. Some of the effects are already being seen. We have seen increase in health risks, mainly due to extreme weather events, like the 2010 heat wave in Europe and the USA, but also many problems involve continual climate change modification. Risks from heat. Number one, we're going to see more deaths and increasing diseases, mainly from very hot days. The benefits are we're going to have fewer winter deaths. It's going to be less hot.
Hi, John. Forgive me. I can't see your PowerPoint. There we go.
Apologies. Oh wait, it's share PowerPoint. Need to go back here. Okay, share screen. Sorry, it's my mistake there. You want me to start again? Okay, I'm gonna share that. Share screen. Can you see it now? David? Hello.
I can see your screen, John.
Okay, I apologize. I'm not going to see you, but I hope we had a problem there.
No, thank you. I appreciate it. We're good to go.
Okay. I'm also thank you for your opinion.
Heart conditions, asthma is going to increase for very young people. Homeless people are going to have these problems as well because of heat wave. We saw in Los Angeles where we had 4 to 8-fold increase in heat wave days. Chicago also seen that as well, in the Midwest especially. Going forward, if you look at the stress in terms of just heat increase, the moment the heat increases to this point here, we're looking at very, very high temperature, anything between 5 to 30 degrees increase in temperature, they're likely to see a lot of deaths occurring as we saw in Europe. And this is especially going to affect those who are very, very old or very vulnerable or very young, young people. A European study of admissions just indicated that anytime you have a 1 degree rise in temperature, we see admissions going up to about 4.5%, just by 1 degree increase in temperature. The heat wave in France in 2010 saw the doubling of death rate to about 700 people per day, which is quite significant. The same in Chicago in 1995. So what can we do? The two things we can do. One, we can adapt. And second thing we can do is mitigate. Where adaptation here is looking at efforts to anticipate, to prepare for these effects of climate change, and thereby to reduce the associated health burden or impact on human health. Mitigation, on the other hand, relates to the issue of slowing down or stabilizing or even reversing the effect of climate change by reducing greenhouse gas emissions. Now, the examples I'm going to be giving out are dealing with those two elements there. One, we're going to talk about adaptation and also mitigation within the built environment. And I'm going to use examples from my research with my students and the things that were done at different times. Now, the first example here is called intelligent and adaptive facade systems, which is used to reduce heat gain through buildings. This was something I did with my student who was looking at Saudi Arabia and a lot of solar gain that you see there because of glass buildings that they have there. We can apply them even here in the US where we live, the Midwest. My student was called Mohammed Al-Tabaiti. We did this work in 2014. And generally, when you're looking at facades of buildings, facades actually work mainly for several things. One, it filters the environment to protect the interior environment. Secondly, facades are used to reduce energy consumption. Thirdly, also to deal with controlling lighting. And fourthly, the issue of ventilation, allowing air to move through buildings or to get out. And fifthly, the issue of the quality of the indoor environment. Here's an example of traditional buildings in the Middle East. They had what you call mashrabiya, which is basically these wooden screens that are used, number one, to reduce heat gain, number two, to filter light, and number three, to provide privacy. Very simple system that could be used to reduce heat in buildup into the environment. In the future, we're looking at the issue of intelligent facades, intelligent kinetic facades. So we're looking at a case where the screens actually do change. They do move as the light level increases. As the sun rises and the angle of the sun increases, then you find that the blinds begin to change and rotate automatically to reduce how much light comes in and, of course, heat comes into the building. So they're rotating based on the environment. They perform automatically without you being there. The typical blinds that we have in the house, you must change them. So if you're not there, the buildup keeps increasing. In this case, you don't have to worry about that because it will just change with amount of sunlight coming right through. The way it works is very simple. We have perception, which is sensing, and then there's a data analysis, which is reasoning, and then there's a response, which is adaptive. It adapts to the environment outside to ensure that we control the heat or lighting within that environment there. The example here that we did, we had two boxes built, which are 4 feet by 4 feet by 4 feet. We had two windows in them. And we did simulation, dynamic simulation, and also physical model, where we basically looked at Miami. We tested blinds, which were running horizontally and vertically, and also combined the two blinds to see what the effect might be. So that's what they look like. We're looking at louvers, which were placed horizontally on the box on the left, and then the box on the right is horizontal. And the equation is basically governed by several things. One, the width of the blade becomes important, the spacing of the louvers become important, and of course the angle of the sun becomes important, and the louver tilt angle becomes important. So all those elements have to be controlled in this case. These are the boxes that we had, and that's how we placed them to test the experiment. What we're doing was we're measuring the temperature inside the box, and also measuring heat flux, how much heat goes through the box itself, and then running an air conditioning system at the back and seeing what's required to maintain a comfortable temperature within the box. So one box was a test box, and the other box was a box for testing the different configuration or adaptation to it. Results were very simple. When we had horizontal blinds, we were looking at savings of about 24% in terms of kilowatt hour use. So you can see in blue, energy consumption in the boxes without blinds, in red, energy consumption at different times of the day from 11 to 4 o'clock for blinds that were actually horizontally placed for that latitude. It depends on where you're located. Some may work best for vertical, some may work best for horizontal. We tested the vertical shading devices and we found that the savings were much less, about 6%, mainly because of the angle of the sun in Miami. Vertical blinds don't work very well for that location. They work better for area around the equator. So if you're in Northern Hemisphere or Southern Hemisphere, then horizontal blinds work much better than vertical blinds here. We tried also combining the two blinds, which is like an egg crate where one blind goes horizontally, the other blind goes vertically, and we found that the savings are about 36%, which is quite good as well. So either way, either it's best to have vertical blinds or combined blinds as opposed to horizontal blinds. So here's a comparison between the consumptions. As you can see here, the combined, the consumption is much lower, and of course, indoor temperature is much lower as well, while this none in blue is much, much higher in terms of just trying to control the environment there. So we can actually save energy consumption, but in the range of 15 to 36%. Now, how does that affect the climate change and temperature rise? What you're doing basically here is that because we don't run the air conditioning at a very high level, if we have these blinds here, we're reducing the greenhouse gas emission and therefore mitigating the issue of emission and environmental pollution, which increases our climate change. Of course, one building is just one building, but if you scale this up to several buildings, then the impact is quite significant. Remembering that residential buildings consume about 40% of energy consumption around the world. Case two, we're looking at effect of what you call living walls. This is just basically, what do you do if the building already exists? What are some of the ways you can do if there's no window on it? And this is a case where we're looking at just planting, just live planting within the wall itself. I did this with a master's student as well, Ahiwo Tefera, in 2015. And there's several kinds of walls you can do, green walls. The first one here is what you call the green facade, which you see on the left-hand side. We actually apply a system and then they grow along the trellis on the outside. The second one is called living wall, where you provide actually the growth material within the wall itself. So they grow within the wall itself. And the third one is called the bio wall, which is mainly used for interior application for cleaning up air, providing better ventilation. For example, in cases where you have high CO2 levels in a building during the day, plants on the inside will reduce that by actually absorbing that and using it. So in this case, we built two boxes as well. And with these same boxes, what you did was we placed sensors at the locations shown there, one in the corner, because we have what we call thermal bridging there, one in the center, and one on the outside. So we're looking at how much heat comes onto the surface on the outside, and then how much of that is transmitted on the inside. We built the boxes based on building code regulations for Florida to ensure that we can compare with existing buildings there. And then the other box, we planted plants on the outside as a medium material, and we compared the temperature again on the outside with the temperature on the inside, and we measured the heat flux to see any impact in terms of heat growth through that element there. The key thing here, we're looking at mainly insulation level. We increase insulation level for those walls using very simple natural methods, using nature as a model to reduce impact of on the environment. When we compared the temperatures here, what we found was as follows. One, the box with plants actually had a very low temperature. The temperature inside was very steady, 25 degrees, while the one which didn't have any plants, the temperature would actually increase to as high as about 37 degrees, and then of course go down to 25 degrees, and then it goes up again to about 38, 37 degrees. So it's very useful in mitigating the heat buildup on the inside, which is very, very helpful in mitigating the need for air conditioning and therefore reducing how much consumption is required, and thereby also reducing what you call the greenhouse gas emissions on the outside. The heat flux can see here again, heat flux is very, very high for the bare box. When you compare this to the one without the bare box, you can see temperature changes again and the heat flux is very, very low. So it's very, very critical here that we can look at ways of reducing consumption in buildings by just planting especially southern walls, eastern walls, and western walls to reduce that huge heat load within the building. We can do that on the roofs as well as green roofs, and we reduce heat load quite significantly by using what you call the green wall or a green roof system. The last one that we did also was based on simulation mainly. It was simulation of passive ground coupling system, which is a geothermal system really. Except here, what we're doing is that we're taking air that's outside, which is very hot, we bring it into the ground, and then it gets cooled by the earth naturally, and then bring it back into the building at a lower temperature to reduce the need for air conditioning here. We use a very simple, typical house. And the argument here is that if you look at any house in Southern Florida, 12.3% of energy is used for space cooling, and 30% is used for space heating in the Northern Hemisphere. So if you combine those two together, you're looking at 30.7 plus 12.3 is almost about 43%, mainly from heating and cooling. If you add water heating, we're looking at about slightly more than 50%. So all that can actually be reduced by coupling to the earth system or coupling to the solar system to rely on solar energy to either heat or to cool the building there. So this is a typical ASHRAE psychometric chart. We're looking at comfort zone, which falls within the small area you can see there where the box is. And the darker area, which is highlighted, is actually what you call extended or adaptive comfort system here under ASHRAE standards. The example we took from nature here comes from a very old study. There's a guy called Kirmiz who actually looked at rats in Egypt called Jerboa rats that burrow underground. It's just like the typical hog. They go underground, they go down to about 1.25 meters or 1.5 meters below ground. The temperature there is very, very stable. It's typically 2.5 to 4.5 degrees below the outside ambient air temperature. So they looked at these rats and they found that they burrow actually underground because temperatures are stable, either very, very hot day of the year, or if you're in cold climate, they go underground when it's very cold and the temperature is very, very stable. And we said, well, if we use this system here and we look at the temperature profile of the ground, then we can find that actually if you go below frost line, we can actually heat buildings in the winter or cool buildings in the summer. In my case here, what we did was we had a container house, a small container building, and we basically got tunnels underground with tubes. We provided air with a small fan to pull the air through. And when air went through those fans there, we're able to find the temperature on the outside and on the inside of the box is quite stable. Maximum ground temperature in South Florida is about 28 degrees centigrade. And we use this system here to check if that may actually work. Thank you very much. And that's all I have to share with you for today. Any questions?
John, that was fascinating. I enjoy the thought that you use nature as a model and the use of plants and the burrows of rats was genius. The
groundhog all the time. The groundhog comes in spring. Well, the groundhog knows that if he goes down underground and stays there the whole winter, they're comfortable. They don't freeze. They don't die of hypothermia. So if we connect the building to the ground, what you're doing is we're having what you call low-grade heating from the ground and bringing it into the building itself. And it works very well. It's a very simple system. It's been used in Japan for actually heating buildings in very extreme winter conditions.
John, if I can ask you to monitor the chat function, there are several people that have made some comments, and I'll take a... It should say chat. Don't see that. Okay. Well, let's see. Robert Hurd says, hello. In our endocrinology class, we talk about a study in Toronto which suggests there will be more diabetes if the average temperature rises. The study was done with pregnancies, which began during the summer versus the winter months. There are more cases of diabetes when the pregnancy began during summer. That's Robert. Robert's a professor at Xavier University, biology, if I recall.
Reducing temperature rise is very, very important. The study was done with pregnancies that began during the summer versus during the winter. There were cases of diabetes when pregnancy began during the summer. That's quite true. So you see, this is very important to keep temperatures low at the same time to keep your pocket actually lined up by not consuming that energy. Last summer, our air conditioning broke out here in South Bend where we live, and the temperature in the house were quite high. And we had to adapt by, you know, using fans and just trying to cool down, because when you try to run the air conditioning, we had a lot of water coming down. And because of that, I thought about just basically getting my house tied to the ground. So this summer, I'm going to just basically couple it down to the ground and use nature to try and cool my house next summer.
John, how is the cost coming down on green technologies?
For example, if you look at something like green wall is not any higher than actually just planting grass on your building. So, for example, you do a green roof, you can use a very low lightweight material, planting material, medium, and just plant regular grass, and you don't have to maintain it. So it's quite significantly low right now. Secondly, if you're looking at things like geothermal systems were out of reach. Geothermal systems now, say for example in Indiana, they're still around 18,000 for a house of 1,500 square feet. However, the government does provide incentives which can cover as much as about of the 18,000, they can cover about 12,000. If you look at the payback period, then for you is that you can pay that within about 4 to 5 years, which is quite reasonable.
Have you applied your research in the third world?
See, here I've been using the third world for a long time. When I was growing up as a child, all our water heating came from solar heating. We had what you call PV thermal solar heater, and we just took our showers around 4 or 5 o'clock in the afternoon, and the hotel was quite warm. Now, I was in Haiti, I think 2014, 15, 16, working on a project. And one of the things we're doing in that project there was to look at ways of reducing reliance on charcoal. They're burning trees and they're basically cutting down trees, and that's causing irrigation, erosion, and then of course causing hunger and other problems. So what we're suggesting to them was to rely on a biomass system. So they are pit latrines. So we worked with them to show that you can tie the pit latrines in the home that they had, and then use that for biogas to produce basically energy that they need for cooking and reduce the need to cut firewood. Secondly, we also worked with them in the issue of reducing reliance on trees by planting bamboo. Bamboo grows very quickly, they can hold the ground very well and reduce the erosion. So this has been tried actually elsewhere. Myself, I'm just going to work on that. I'm going to India in January. I'm going to begin to look at how to apply that in southern India. So I'll be spending some time, I've got some grant to look at that. So I'll work on this in the next 2 years in India.
It appears to me that it's really the third world that's driving the demand for green energy. China, India, these are countries that don't have natural coal and oil supplies. But I see even the car companies are adjusting and moving to electric, mostly driven by the demand for cars in India and China. Oh, I'm sorry, I wasn't. I see that much of the demand for green technology is coming from the third world. India and China don't have natural carbon repositories, and so they're even driving companies like GM to change to electric cars.
Carbon-based energy. You don't have really a choice here. You really have to cut it. You just have to find ways of reducing it, its consumption, which is quite significant if you're elsewhere. So China's a big manufacturer. Solar panels are very cheap now and very efficient. And they're also driving the technology in terms of using things like what you call solar air conditioning systems. And so they don't rely on electricity to cool out your buildings, which is a big consumption here.
Electricity is still cheap in many parts of this country, and much of that has to do with old utilities that are fully paid for, coal-fired plants. And yet they're at a point where we need to make a transition to green energy or an intermediate step like fracked gas, which is not necessarily the best environmental solution. Do you see a lot of enthusiasm among the students in the architectural school for a push towards green?
Teach long-lasting buildings and reduction in resource consumption. So in that case, that's our emphasis there. As a university itself here, one of the things we talk about is the issue of ethics, making decisions that actually go beyond today, beyond short-term solutions today. So for example, the University of Notre Dame has made a decision that they won't have any coal plants here running for energy in the next, I think it's like 5 years or so. They're building gas-fired plants, and they're reducing reliance on coal. So they're making that decision on ethics, not because of cost. It's actually cheaper to run coal than to run gas. But they're saying, you know, ethically, it doesn't make sense for us to continue doing this because we can actually do that. Yes, somebody has a
question. Somebody have a question? I did post a link to your website, John. If anybody would like to learn more about John's work, feel free to click through. Very good. John, do you have any concluding thoughts or a prayer for our audience?
Yeah, my thoughts are, one, we should always make ethical decisions. Whenever we decide on things, think of somebody else beyond you. So when I make a decision to drive 3 miles and I could walk the 3 miles, that gas has to come from somewhere. Somebody has to do the job to get a gas to me, and they get underpaid. And so making those ethical decisions becomes very, very important. So as a builder or as a consumer of energy, we should always think about our behavior in terms of what happens within our actions. In terms of prayer, one of the things that I can always refer guys back to is Christ. Christ was actually, it's a good example of our model where Christ was a steward. Reduction in our consumption habits, reduction in our behavioral habits. So my prayer is that for us as Christians, We should fundamentally make ethical decisions in all the things we do, as opposed to making decisions that actually lie in our pockets, because our our future is for our children and our grandchildren. We should leave a better future for them here on this world. That's my prayer for all of them.
Amen. Amen. Ladies and gentlemen, Professor John Onyango of the School of Architecture at the University of Notre Dame, we're proud and very grateful to have you with us today. This is the last of our fall semester webcast series. However, Cardinal Peter Turkson will be joining us to conclude the Environment and Sustainability webcast series at a date to be announced. We'll email you an invitation when we know for sure the exact date. Cardinal Turkson is a Ghanaian cardinal of the Roman Catholic Church. He was president of the Pontifical Council for Justice and Peace from 2009 to 2017. Pope Francis named him the first prefect of the Dicastery for the Promotion of Integral Human Development, which began operations on the 1st of January in 2017. Cardinal Turkson and his team wrote the first draft of the encyclical Laudato Si. In drafting the encyclical, the Vatican consulted with leading scientific experts for months. On the 28th of April in 2015, in advance of the encyclical's release, the Vatican hosted a one-day conference on climate change featuring Cardinal Turkson and United Nations General Secretary Ban Ki-moon. The encyclical was released just prior to COP20, and since release, Cardinal Turkson has been traveling the globe talking about Laudato Si. It's been suggested that the encyclical's release was timed to influence three summits being held at the United Nations on financial aid, sustainable development, and climate change later in 2015. And the document has had some influence on Catholic and Republican candidates running for office during the 2016 presidential elections. We'll keep you apprised and hope you can join us for the closing Globe Ethics Net Environment and Sustainability webcast series lecture by Cardinal Peter Turkson. I'll conclude our program today with a two-minute overview of Globe Ethics. We will be completing production of our dramatic illustrated reading of Laudato Si, and we'll send you the full reading before Christmas, our gift to you. During the months of December and January, we'll be editing the 36 lectures in our 2018 Globe Ethics Live series with closed captioning for translation into over 100 languages, and we'll email them to you as they become available. I'll send you a notification when Cardinal Turkson is available to meet with us, and we hope to join you again during the spring semester with a new Globe Ethics Live series of fascinating ethics lectures. We hope you'll join us again next season. In the interim, we wish you a Merry Christmas. May God's peace be with you always.
As the world becomes increasingly interconnected and the problems of today grow in severity and size, impacting more and more people, the importance of ethics and values-driven leadership has never been greater. At GlobeEthics.net, bearing in mind this reality, we believe that access to knowledge, resources on ethics and values, and the empowerment of people from all over the world, from a religious and non-religious perspective, will improve ethical reflection, action, and cooperation at both a local and global level. For this reason, we promote values-driven leadership for life and sustainable development through the expansion of a global online network. GlobeEthics.net is based on six fundamental values: responsibility, sharing, respect, inclusion, justice, fairness, integrity. To translate these values into action, we provide access to resources, we facilitate networking, we stimulate research, we develop projects that put ethics and values into practice, with a focus on higher education institutions, business schools, students, and teachers. And we also work together with the business, religious, and public sectors. We concentrate primarily on educational ethics and work also on public services ethics, economic ethics, and inner religious ethics. This is expressed through four main activities. 1. Knowledge and library. We provide the largest free online library of resources on ethics, ecumenism, and theology. In 2017, the library had more than 5 million documents, including journals, special collections, books, and reference works. And it is still growing. We also offer access to new services, all related to the thematic, linguistic, and regional priorities of globeethics.net. 2. Dialogue and Network. In 2017, our online network had more than 180,000 participants from 220 countries and territories in over 9,000 organizations listed in 3 fully searchable online directories on ethics and responsibility, business ethics, and theological education. This virtual network allows participants to communicate and publicize information of interest and encourages face-to-face interaction among its members through our international events and calls for action. 3. Research and Publications. Research topics are developed through our network and online research groups, and the results of this work are made available in our publications, which are multilingual, interdisciplinary, high quality, and can be downloaded for free at our website. 4. Projects. We provide formation, training, international events, and certification programs globally and locally for the development of values-driven leadership. Our global coverage is growing thanks to the integrated work of our International Board of Foundation, our Geneva headquarters, our regional programs, key pillars for our global strategic development, our national contacts, the various partner organizations, and the thousands of individual participants. GlobeEthics.net was founded in 2004, and our vision remains the same: to see a world where people, and especially leaders, act according to ethical values. We want you to be part of this group of leaders who seek to transform society. Join our global network, register for free, and move forward together with us toward values-driven leadership for life and sustainable development.
Thank you.